All right, welcome to the Marriage Boss Podcast, Episode 12. I'm very excited today because I have one of my transformational speaking heroes, Gail Larsen, with us today. And Gail is the founder of Real Speaking, and she can be found at realspeaking.com, and she's the award-winning author of Transformational Speaking. If you want to change the world, tell a better story. That's how I found her. Her work has been described by Fast Company as transforming your relationship to your voice via the deepest stirrings of your soul. Gail delights in finding in each person finding their distinctive and influential way to speak from the truth of who they are. That's vital to our relationships, as well as to the public speaking approach that Gail teaches. Her work draws out what people most care about to open hearts, inspire change, and move people to act. Gail is an SBA award-winning entrepreneur and catalyst for life-affirming ventures. Her original approach to communication draws from her own journey as a previously reluctant speaker and her respect for indigenous wisdom and 25 years in the world of speaking and wide experience in business and association management. Gail offers transformational speaking to a global audience through both her online academy and monthly live immersions in Santa Fe, New Mexico. In 2014, she also instigated the annual Holy Fool's Day extravaganza, an online event celebrating people who step outside convention to find their voices and become the radical change artists their souls are calling them to be. So I'm very happy to have her on the show. Gail, welcome to the Marriage Boss Podcast.
Thanks, Rick.
It's so
good
terrific.
To be with you.
It's so terrific to have you on the show. When I found out about your work, I was instantly attracted to it, and I found it to be quite different than a lot of other speaking teaching and transformational speaking teaching that's out there. So unique, so different, and I was immediately drawn in. So I'm so happy to have you here to share this information with our audience.
Thank you.
So before we get started, can you share a book that has really had a big impact on you, or one that you're reading or have read?
Yes, I want to show you this book by Jonah Sachs, Winning the Story Wars, Why Those Who Tell and Live the Best Stories Will Rule the Future.
Wow.
Because what I loved about this book is, you know, two opposing points of view can have a really good story. That's true in relationships as well as in business, in our global economy, and how we're solving the world's problems. And this is a really wonderful book to find how we find that overarching story that helps us find the best of both.
Wow. And is this a book that you found during your own research? How long ago did you find this book?
A couple of years ago. So I've been in love with it for a while. I'm a member of Social Venture Network, and this man's marketing firm had a booth there, and I started looking at the book and had to read it and really love his capacity to help organizations find a better story in order to prevail.
Okay. Well, we're going to put that in the show notes, so thank you for that. And as I mentioned earlier, Gail is the author of Transformational Speaking, If You Want to Change the World, Tell a Better Story. And as you know, but the audience doesn't know, I was fortunate enough to get an audio version of this book, so I got the opportunity to hear you read it to me firsthand. So I think that was it was so powerful. This information just changed my life instantly, just getting into it to find out what your story was, and I can't wait to hear what you have to say to our audience about it today. Tell me, Gail, you speak about courageous conversations, and tell us about the courageous conversations and your model for addressing conflict.
Yeah, I think for your audience, it's an important thing to consider, because in relationship, we always have these things that need to be addressed. And just like in public speaking, I'm not real interested in formulas, mm-hmm. because formulas keep our minds tracking with things instead of being truly present and in our hearts when we're communicating with people. As you mentioned in my introduction, my work is based very much on indigenous wisdom. I was a student for a long time and friend of Angela Sarian, the cultural anthropologist. And her, you know, her true grounding was in the gift of being who we are individually, as opposed to trying to compete and compare. Mm-hmm. She told a story once about a elder from one of the American Indian tribes going to Congress to discuss a treaty that had been broken. Not an unusual thing in our government's relationship with Indian tribes. Mm-hmm. And I think the way he addressed the problem gives us a beautiful way to look at how we can address conflict with someone who we care about our relationship. So he gets before Congress and he says, first of all, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. And really acknowledging that it was an honor. Mm-hmm. And then he talked about what was working. Fortunately, we've had several treaties with the U.S. government that have worked very well and served us both. And he outlined those. And then he said, however, today I'm here to talk with you about this one, and the treaty does not seem to be working and have been honored. And then he said the beautiful thing that I think shape shifts any conversation. He said, unfortunately, I regret that I have but three possible solutions, because it would be an indigenous way to have multiple, 10, 12 possible solutions. So I'd like to present those, and then I'd like to hear what you think is possible. Mm-hmm. So it's opening something beyond our own capacity to see the whole picture. So I think the model is very much, thank you. What is working?
Oh my God.
What I'd like to talk about today.
Wow.
The possible solutions I found, and then opening it to the other party's way of seeing, but not saying one my way or the highway.
Yeah.
And sometimes in my workshops, I do an exercise where someone will have a partner about the courageous conversation they need to have. So afterwards, I ask for a volunteer, and they get in front of the room and they have the conversation with my coaching. And so I think one of the best ones I heard that has to do with intimate relationship was a woman who'd been married for 15 years and felt like all the juice had gone out of her, and the passion had gone out of their sex life. Mm-hmm. So that could be a pretty difficult conversation to have.
Sure it is.
To say, honey, you just ain't measuring up mm-hmm. the way you used to. What's going wrong here?
Yep, yep.
She said, you know, I'm so happy with our 15 years of marriage. I love our relationship. I love you. I love our kids, our home, our community, our business. Things are working great. And I'm just so in love with you and happy that we found each other. There is one part of our life that I think could be jazzed up a little, and that's what I'd like to talk to you about today. And as I've thought about it, I have three or four ideas, and I'm wondering if you might as well. And so I always ask people after they do this exercise to email me later and tell me how it worked.
Yeah.
She said things had changed quite dramatically. And of course, that was just a beautiful way to approach it. So often there are ways of engaging in conflict and conversation that are formulas. And if you're on the receiving side of that, it doesn't feel real.
Right.
It feels scripted, just mm-hmm. like in public speaking. If yeah. it's scripted, it doesn't feel real. It doesn't feel authentic. It doesn't feel connected. So there's just a short way of dealing with conflict with anyone we care about. But my sense of it is we're always looking for a way in that doesn't escalate it and allows us to have a real conversation.
That is just beautiful, and it's earth-shattering, and it's as you were saying it, I was just thinking about, in addition to our intimate relationships, in families, at work, in the community, you know, anytime we're going to have a conversation, we're usually presenting something, some idea or thought or another way of doing things, and or trying to get some collaborative agreement. And it just sounds like that could be such a terrific tool. Mm-hmm. I thank you for that. That's definitely going to be one of the, you know, on the top of my list from now on. Amazing. Just perfect.
Yeah, and what I've been trying to do is find ways to get into a conversation without escalating.
Yeah.
And one that I received from Angelus Arian when I studied with her that I think is the best one ever is, I'm disappointed in what happened, and I'd like to find a creative solution.
Wow.
That says it without blowing something out of the water.
Yeah.
And another one she would recommend was, you know, if we're really triggered, it's not a good time to be having the conversation.
Yeah.
And one of her ideas for that one was, I am at the height of my pistivity, and I do not trust what will come out of my mouth now.
Yeah.
So it's finding a way to engage that allows the relationship lines to stay open.
Now, what would you suggest that someone who, let's say this just isn't in their nature, they're trying to learn how to begin to use this tool, and they're just very reactive and volatile, and they're used to blowing up at a time like that. How does one learn how to use this tool?
I think just to say, you know, I find myself really triggered right now. Mm-hmm. Our relationship is important, and I want to talk to you, and I know this isn't a good time.
Okay.
But set the time, because otherwise we feel like someone's blowing us off.
Yeah, I can think in my work how many times clients and friends just say, you know, when a money issue happened, that's when we had an argument about it. When there was some kind of a connection issue, or we had to talk about the kids or make a plan for something, we just had a fight at that moment. So I appreciate and love what you're saying, because it really does allow for some diffusion and for some walls to come down, and to really, you know, like you said, set a time.
Mm-hmm.
And that way cooler heads can prevail. So this is just a terrific, terrific technique. Thank you.
You know, I wonder, Rick, and, you know, this is just a question to explore. I think, and I don't know if it's as true for men as women, but a lot of us have had our voices shut down, mm-hmm. and conflict is really hard. And so for a long time in my own life, I was always happy when I was revved up enough in order to engage, even if I was triggered. Because I was afraid if I waited until later, I'd just say it didn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
So I think there's an edge we walk there that we need to be emotionally connected to what it is that created the need for the conversation to begin with. Because there's such a continuum from off the charts angry to totally shut down.
Yeah.
I think we have to learn to trust ourselves and our relationships enough to realize that argument is not a deal breaker.
Yeah, you know, that's a keen observation, because you're right about you can go from highly passionate to passive once the energy goes out of you.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when you get to I don't care. And certainly silence and oppression sets in at that time. And if you string enough of those moments together, you become complacent, and
you're out of there.
yeah, you don't care. And
yeah.
I've seen it in breakups. You know, when both people are not invested anymore,
mm-hmm.
then you got problems.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, good stuff.
So I think it's big work for all of us, and it requires self knowledge, and it requires a partner or someone that we're talking to who is also willing to engage and has something at stake.
Yep. Good stuff. Thank you. So I'm intrigued by your Holy Fool's Day event and celebrating those who really step up in unusual ways. How do people discover the radical change artist their souls are calling them to be?
Mm. Yeah, Holy Fool's Day. I've actually been celebrating it for years when I heard that Joseph Campbell said, the Holy Fool is the most dangerous person on earth because she won't or he won't be controlled.
Yep.
That the hierarchies don't like the Holy Fool because We're not going to play within a very set range of rules. Mm-hmm. So the Holy Fool is looking for that calling of what's ours to do. And last year I started doing an online event called Holy Fool's Day, that to get Holy Fool wisdom for people who are making a difference through choosing unusual paths. I actually watched this year's on Sunday because a friend wanted to see it, and I was inspired all over again. So how do we get inspired? How do we locate? How do we identify what our Holy Fool calling is? I mean, I won't say it's for everyone, but I think maybe there's four questions we can ask ourselves that help us get in touch with what's ours to do.
Okay.
So the first one's, a pretty easy coaching question. What inspires you and brings you alive? Mm-hmm. I'm finding, just having hit a big decade birthday, some of the things that used to inspire me and bring me alive aren't that interesting to me anymore.
Okay.
Like, what is it now? So to get really current, the poet David White said, anything or anyone that does not bring you fully alive is too small for you.
Mm-hmm.
So what is it that brings you alive and delights you? The second question may be more unusual. It's what breaks your heart.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, this Rumi said, break my heart, break it again, so I can love even more again.
Wow.
There's a part of me that says, are you crazy? break my heart again. But the truth is, a heart that's broken is open. It's broken open. And when we look at the things that we just find so painful to even consider, it opens us to that sense of what's really calling me if I had the courage to look at it. For me, it's animals. I mean, there's when I see something about abuse of an animal, it's like, turn off the TV, I can't stand the news. But what if I open my heart to that? And I guess I would say on this, Rick, we are receiving all the time constant appeals for our time, our energy, our contributions. Mm-hmm. If we can answer this question, and I think we know where we can put our energy, where it will matter most and have the greatest internal significance.
Well, it's interesting that you bring it up that way, because that's, for me, how The Marriage Boss was created. I just thought, if I had the challenges in my relationship, which I thought was a good relationship, and I saw how it could impact my family, my kids, my business, my personal life, what is going on in some of the other homes?
Mm-hmm.
And so it really pushed me on a different level to do something about it and to try to help men and women communicate mm-hmm. more, especially entrepreneurial men and women.
Yeah.
And that's, that was how I found it. So that was what broke my heart. And I just thought there was, you gave us an example of, there are so many easier ways to communicate than the ones we're using or the ones we've been brought up using. And so I think that it's just that simple. One courageous conversation can change a family.
Mm-hmm.
So I can identify with that 100%, that my heart was broken, and that's what drove me to do this work.
Yeah. So when we're willing to really see it, then it can lead us to the next step, which you've taken. It's, what does healing look like?
Mm-hmm.
What's the new story around this thing, whatever it is for us, that could actually change things? Because we often get so stuck in the things we think we can't influence or change. And I really believe with this, if we each find our thing to do, that we start seeing change everywhere, but we just get shut down and think it's too big.
Yeah.
So once we know what healing looks like, we may not see a lot of evidence of it, but what would it look like if everyone, if we could see the other side of whatever it is that's breaking our hearts? And then the fourth question is, what's the one life-affirming action I will take consistently with love?
Mm.
Because it's not just thinking about it and knowing it, it's what am I willing to do? When I was in my facilitation training, there was a conversation method we learned called ORID, Objective, Reflective, Interpretive, Decisional. And the belief behind it was, we usually say, here's the problem, here's the solution, the objective and the decisional. And we leave out the processing and thinking styles of the reflective and interpretive to go right to decision.
Yeah.
And so I think when we look even at those four questions, the first one is, what delights me and brings me alive? Well, now what's the one action I will take? Mm-hmm. But when we move into what breaks my heart and what does healing look like, we get a different level of information that's more connected with who we are instead of our good minds, let's figure it out. And I think in personal conversations and conflict, those four ways of looking at how we explore are also important. Objective, reflective, interpretive, decisional are also called what, gut, mm-hmm. so what, and now what. So it's a way of engaging with someone where we get beneath the surface of the problem and what's the solution to what's the deep feeling beneath it. What's my gut reaction? What other experiences have I had with this that caused me to interpret a certain way? And we can create enough understanding that we can move to a mutual decision that's probably going to be more sustainable.
You know, I think just laying that out like that is so consumable and so simple, but yet so powerful on a deep level. And the contrast between the light and dark and the, you know, apparent pleasure and pain of any relationship and or conflict, it makes a lot of sense when you visit the darkness to get your true answers, because there's a lot of truth in the pain. And mm-hmm. and there's also an impetus for movement and change in our pain. So this is watershed stuff. I knew that you were going to bring it. I knew that when I read your book, I was just, I couldn't wait, and I was hoping that you would come and give us this information. So I just thank you so much.
Well, none of these things. Well, I guess ORID is in my book, but when I saw the focus of your show, it felt like some of this other information beyond, you know, really moving into our strength and power as speakers would be of interest to your audience. So thank you for the opportunity.
Oh, just incredible. Thank you. So again, let's just review. I know that you have a free report, 6 Radical Truths to Transform Your Speaking, and that is on Gail's site at www.transformationalspeakingonline.com, which is also the home of your online academy, which I want everybody to visit. And then again, to remind our audience, check out the book, Transformational Speaking. If you want to change the world, tell a better story. I thought it was earth-shattering, and I'll put all this stuff in the show notes. Gail, thank you so much for joining me today. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, Rick. Great blessings to you.
You too. Talk to you soon.
Bye.
Bye-bye.